Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Sustaining Sustainability. I'm your host, C.B. Bhattacharya, professor and director of the Center for Sustainable Business at the University of Pittsburgh. This week, we will be doing something a little different. Last week was the University of Pittsburgh's Center for Sustainable Business's biannual meeting with our sponsor companies, where we were lucky enough to hear from Paul Polman, ex-CEO of Unilever, co-founder and CEO of Imagine, and a member of the center's Strategic Advisory Council. Paul recently wrote a book on how to build net positive companies that thrive by giving more than they take. In order to amplify his messages on the relatively low costs of action versus the high costs of inaction on global challenges, and the need for businesses to get off the sidelines and take leadership on these issues, we wanted to share a portion of his address directly on this podcast so our listeners can also benefit from his valuable insights. We will begin his address shortly, but before I sign off for this time, I want to say that this podcast is made possible with the help of my colleagues, Chris Gassman, Associate Director at the Center for Sustainable Business, and Danny Nye, who is Center Associate at the Center for Sustainable Business. Once again, I'm C.B. Bhattacharya. This is Sustaining Sustainability, and I look forward to seeing you again next time.
Most of you know the challenges. I hope all of you know that our global economic system, if you like it or not, is broken. We have discovered that we can't have infinite growth on a finite planet, and anything you can do infinitely is by definition unsustainable. Earth Overshoot Day this year, which is the day that we use up more resources than the world can replenish, actually was July 29th. In my definition, that means that after that date, we're actually stealing from future generations. So COVID has also pointed out to us not only the enormous costs of this destruction, because it's a direct result, by the way, of our destruction of biodiversity, of, in fact, the devastating effects of climate change. The big surprise here should not have been another zoonotic disease. After all, we've had SARS, Zika, Ebola, Asian flu, and many more things. The big surprise actually is the inability of governments to work together to get it under control. Irresponsible behavior, if I may call it that way, politely, at government level in many countries has caused hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of innocent citizens to die. Disrespect for science was one of the main reasons for that. The revelation of COVID has definitely been that we can't have healthy people on an unhealthy planet. More people also have understood this broad relationship that is there between biodiversity, human health, climate change, social and racial inequalities in general, and the overall economy. That complexity is now well understood, and people now also are better aware of the need for having these 17 goals in the US UN Sustainable Development Goals, why they are all interrelated. This is a complex world. Above all, we've actually been able to show with COVID that the cost of not acting and dealing with these issues has been significantly higher than the cost of acting. In fact, COVID until now, just to save lives and livelihoods, has cost $17 trillion of money that basically the US and Europe have pumped into their economies. And the story isn't finished. The IMF estimates that we've lost about $27 trillion in GDP over this decade. People are starting to realize that the cost of inaction is higher than the cost of action. And I think that is one of the reasons why you see the financial market jump on it. Contrary to the belief of the normal skeptics and cynics that we've heard many times and that the newspapers like to worship, the COVID crisis did not result in putting ESG on the back burner. In fact, quite the opposite. We've seen an acceleration, actually, of the number of countries making commitments to be net zero by 2050, or in the case of China, 2060. Net zero, by the way, under those timeframes is needed to stay below the 1.5 degrees warming, which is highly recommendable. Now we have from 30% of the carbon emissions, we have now about 70% of the carbon emissions under these agreements. The private sector has moved from virtually no company setting science-based targets for 2050. We now have about 20% of major companies making these commitments. In fact, in every industry, including the high abatement industries or the high emitting industries, we see companies making these commitments. And yes, the financial market has moved. In fact, we have put together a coalition of financial institutions with over $90 trillion of money under management that has made a commitment to decarbonize their portfolio to be net zero by 2050. So things are moving, but there are a few problems. If 20% of the companies make a commitment, 80% still doesn't. If a lot of the countries make commitments for 2050 to be net zero, very few of them have put that into practice or made commitments to get significant progress, which we know is needed by 2030. In fact, the IPCC estimates and the UN FCCC has confirmed that all the submissions from the countries that have come in for the COP26 now, which is a year later than it should have been because of COVID, actually point to a 16% increase in emissions over the 10 years to 2030, when we really need a 45% decline. So here is where the challenge is, and here is where my argument is. If it's difficult on the front of multilateralism, if it's difficult on the front of national politics, if our politicians all over the world have become increasingly populist, xenophobic, or nationalist, or actually more short-term, hopping from one election cycle to the other, we cannot just sit there and blame them. Business cannot succeed in societies that fail, nor can business be a bystander in a system that gives them life in the first place. Our argument is very simple in the book, that business needs to step up. Now, what does that stepping up look like? And what does it look like to fill that void and to a certain extent de-risk that political process? Many companies are barely staying on the right side of the law. They might have a hard time keeping their cash flow positive, but the majority of companies think that others should solve the problems of the world, that they can discharge these negative externalities and get away with it. And frankly, the newspapers are full of that on a daily basis. But increasingly, there's a group of companies that says, yeah, I need to be CSR, corporate socially responsible. But corporate social responsibility deals with being less bad. In a world that is already overshooting its planetary boundaries, where we already have the issues well beyond where we need to stabilize and to be in harmony with fellow human citizens and planet Earth, just being less bad is not enough. Think about a murderer that kills 10 people that now publicly declares, I'm only going to kill 5. Am I a better murderer? It just doesn't work that way. So some companies are catching on and some CEOs say, no, it's not about being CSR. It's actually about being sustainable, neither good nor bad, applaudable, difficult to get to for some, hard work, undoubtedly. But just being neither good nor bad is really not acceptable either, when we know that so many more people have to be lifted out of poverty, that so many others aspire to have access to some of the basic human rights, like food or like toilets or like clean air and many of the other things. So ultimately, we need to start thinking collectively in terms of being restorative, regenerative, reparative, to get back to that balance that we all aspire to now and for generations to come. So in our book, we call that net positive, how courageous companies thrive by giving more than they take. And our simple premise is that companies should profit not from creating the world's problems, but actually from solving the world's problems. The book is asking a very simple question of, is this world better off because you as a company are in it or not? And we don't spend much time on the why anymore. We've really taken the science as given and Milton Friedman as dead and buried a long time ago. We've really focused far more on the how. It's not a story about Unilever. It's not a story about myself. It's really the best practices that we see on the journey of helping companies become net positive. What are the hallmarks of a net positive company? A net positive company, first and foremost, takes responsibility of its total handprint in society, not just its footprint. Many companies outsource their value chains and also outsource their responsibilities. That doesn't work anymore. Many companies make commitments for scope 1 and 2 and claim that they don't have transparency on scope 3 or 4, or what we argue in the book, scope 5 or 6. That doesn't work anymore. You have to take full responsibility of your total impact. The second thing is you have to optimize the return for all of your stakeholders. If you want to run this longer term model to be around for the long term, it automatically brings you to sustainability. It automatically brings you to optimizing the returns for all of your stakeholders. Your employees or your people in the value chain being probably the most important ones. And shareholder return is a result of what you do, not a myopic objective. And the net positive companies play an active role in terms of driving the broader system changes. They go beyond their companies to drive changes that are in the interest of your industry, of society, and they realize that by doing so, they're ultimately better off themselves as well. What it requires or what it needs, as the book will argue, is leadership, big transformative partnerships, and seizing these enormous opportunities. And they go all together. You cannot get systems change if you don't have organizational change, and you cannot have organizational change if you don't have personal or leadership change. The book spends a lot of time on a chapter which is called The Elephants in the Room, which is talking about the need to be consistent. How do you deal with CEO salaries, with tax or tax avoidance, with corruption, with human rights in the value chain, with trade associations advocating different things than some of the companies publicly preach, with money in politics, and many of these burning issues where CEOs increasingly will be held to a higher standard and to the test. Coming to the standards, it is very important that we rebuild trust in society, and rebuilding trust can only happen with transparency. And transparency comes from setting these clear targets, announcing these targets, and holding people accountable. And many of the things that require progress for the financial market to decide if they put their money in it, for employees to decide if they want to work for companies, for CEOs to steer, sometimes in the darkest of nights in the storms, you need a dashboard and you need your programs. On a macro level, we need to change our economic system by ensuring that we put a value on environmental and social capital. That is rapidly starting to happen. And internalizing these externalities, if you want to, is a very important thing. Someone very wise once says, we treasure what we measure. And that is also true. But it is also important for comparability or materiality. The financial market would be able to better allocate their capital. It is starting to happen already. Now, in order to accelerate that process to this better, more inclusive world, we have to increasingly ensure that the governments provide the right frameworks to do that. And standard setting is probably still one of the most effective ways to do. The IFRS is looking at the Sustainable Standard Board. Europe itself is going further than materiality in the European Green Deal and the related legislation around that. And I also think that increasingly, they actually will be able to influence the behavior in other parts of the world as well. One example of that is simply the border tax adjustments that are going to happen in Europe for imports coming from countries that have not taken the needed climate change mitigation actions, for example. So standard setting is important for many of the reasons that you are well familiar with, but at a crucial time right now. I think many people will say, ultimately, it's the accountants that change the world. Some of the people have laughed about that, but I think there's a little bit of an element of truth in that. And we're now seeing broadly that, be it the major asset owners or asset managers, be it the major responsible companies in the world, some of the countries that are considering to be their pioneers, especially when it gets to carbon and climate change, that increasingly we will see an acceleration of these standards. Does that mean more standards? Not at all. My argument here again is the same. If the private sector would responsibly embrace that and be part of that solution versus in some corners resisting that as more bureaucracy, more standards, more government. But what if we work together and get the right legislation, not the wrong legislation? It will unlock markets. It will move us into that right, greener, more inclusive direction that we need, which happens to be more profitable, which happens to generate more employment and more resilient jobs, and which happens to create that world that now 95% of citizens of this world, CEOs of the companies and many others are asking for. So that's the task that we have ahead of ourselves. And the first proof of the pudding before we open it up to questions is in fact the COP26 again, where I will be in 2 weeks' time to really see if we can move away from declarations and promises like we have so many of, and get into real actions. Actions to restore nature, actions to get out of coal, to stop financing coal abroad, to have the courage to get at least to the 100 billion green fund to help emerging markets adapt to this situation that frankly they haven't been responsible for, but pay a tremendous price. And these are the specific things, countries making commitments between now and 2030. And this is what we're focused on. I can only tell you that I've never seen such a momentum from the private sector, from civil society. Not surprisingly, angst is growing. People are outraged at the speed with which we're moving. But there's also a certain level of hope or optimism that if we work together, take this net positive trajectory that we're advocating for, that we have it in our means, as well as in our time frame, to solve these issues and be proud of what we achieve for us, for the citizens that are left behind, and also for future generations.